Okay, so this is what you'll be making, of course. Then audio visual loop, and this is it right here. And you might have already seen this preview on the channel, and then also in the two or three live streams which I've done where I may have looked at this as well. Okay, so here's an earlier version of the scene in Cinema 4D, and this is what we're going to be breaking down. And there will be a shorter separate video which just goes through the After Effects section, just the basic compositing. Most of the look was actually achieved in Cinema, and then just a few minor things later in After Effects. Okay, here's what I'm going to do here. I'm going to just copy some of the elements in this scene to a new project. And if I just paste them here, this is what it looks like. So what is this exactly? So these are the sections that you see the camera flying through, and that is three different versions of this. Actually, no, just two different versions, but two of them are the same. So let me show you what I mean. This is the sort of, I guess, the main one, because it has that orange glowing thing in the middle. And if I show you how this was built, so let me disable the cloner. You will see that it's made up of these three tubes, which, you know, tubes normally come in like this, you know, like a circular shape. But I just put the rotation segments at 6, which turned them into hexagons like this. And it's just three hexagons arranged in this way. So the main one is in the middle, the glowing orange color, which, by the way, is just a luminance material with a Fresnel that's yellow on one side and orange on the other. And then there was one on the inside and one on the outside, and they all had a fillet cap enabled. So these beveled edges, and that's just easy, you know, in the tube here you have the fillet turned on, and then you set it to whatever size that you want. Okay, so that's it for that main piece. So if I turn this back on, you see that it's in this honeycomb pattern. And this is something which I've covered in a separate tutorial, so I won't go into too much detail. And actually, in new versions of Cinema 4D above version 18, this is actually very easy to do because it's in a cloner. The way I did this, because I don't have R18, I had to set the object to mode, and the object is this plane. So if I enable lines so you can see this clearer, and if I grab this plane and enlarge it, you can see how that's working. And, you know, like I said, I've gone through this in a separate video, but if you use a plane as your object, set the distribution to edge, and then untick align clone, you need to untick that. And yeah, you just make sure this is the correct size for these to line up edge to edge perfectly. In the newer version of Cinema 4D, depending on when you're watching this video, version 18 and onwards has a cloner mode, which you can do this without going through that setup. So this technique is obsolete for those versions of Cinema 4D above 18, but whatever, moving on. If I switch this off then, so I can show you the other pieces. So this is the second one, and it's different, but it's exactly the same setup, just three tubes. Except this time the one in the middle is longer than the two on the outside, and I've applied the same texture to all three. And in fact, I could probably just do this instead of putting the texture on the individual tubes, just put one big texture on the null, and it's going to look exactly the same. And I'm actually going to do the same here too. Okay, and these are the same again, and the reason being that if you look at the example, every third thing is the one with the glowing orange. So you need two of the same, and then the third one is different. Then from here, I take a helix spline, and this needs to be going into Z space. I'm gonna go to the attributes. Let's set the height to 10,000, not 1,000, so another zero there. And also I need more subdivisions, so I'll set this to 10,000. And I will get a cloner. Let's drop all three of these cloners now into this one new cloner. And I'm going to re-enable this one so it shows up too. And the mode will be set to object, and the object is the helix spline. And already you can start to see what's going on here. Now this is clearly not enough clones, so we'll bump this all the way up to a much higher number. But before I do that, I'll just make sure that render instances is ticked so that this will be faster for moving around in the scene. If you don't know what this does, right click and show help, and I'm sure there's something about this in the manual. Basically, it makes it faster. That's the fastest way to describe that. Okay, so I'm going to have 50 clones. Okay, so we have this array of these clones just going into Z space. And now if I get a camera, I can put a align to spline tag on this, and the spline path is going to be that helix spline as well. If I go into the camera, which I'm already in, I need to set this tangential switch to be switched on, and now the camera is looking down the tunnel, which is exactly what we want. So if I just quickly jump out of the camera to look at it from this point of view. If this is too slow for your computer, or maybe you can't handle this amount of clones, you can always just disable the second level clones, so we are left with just the center row of hexagons, and this is now more responsive. And then when we go to do the render and setting up other things, that's when we can turn these back on. So I'm actually going to do that here. All right, so we can see where the camera is at the beginning of that spline. Depending on how you put that helix spline into your scene, this may be on the other side, so you just have to reverse that switch. Now you see it's over here, so but we needed to start at the beginning, which was correct. Anyway, all right, so if I go into the camera, I'm gonna go to the position. Let me first of all put my timeline length to 8 seconds, and I will animate the position. So at frame 0, this will be at 02, and then at the end of the 8 second duration, I will set this to just 50, not 100, just 50. And you will see why that's important for the looping shortly. I'm gonna go to my timeline, make sure that this is a linear timeline, and I'm going to jump back into this, and if I just quickly play this, now you can see we have our animation. Now the reason this is going to loop, or at least this is the first step towards looping this correctly, you saw there was a bit of a jump at the end there, so it's not perfectly lined up. But if you look at this from a distance, the position of the camera at the beginning here, the way it's angled and oriented, is exactly the same as it is at 50%, because you know our helix spline with that 10,000 height is this long spline, and if you were to slice this in half, the two pieces you end up with are exactly the same. So you know what the camera is looking at the beginning here is the same as what the camera is looking at halfway, at the halfway point. And that's how the looping is done in this particular case. Now you could have set this up you know, any other way. The idea is you just want your camera to be looking at the same thing at the beginning as at the end, So maybe I would have maybe had a a circular spline. That would have been very easy to set up the loop, because naturally a circle just loops back on itself. But in this case, we're just doing the trick with what the camera is looking at, rather than basing it on the shape of the spline completely. Anyway, I hope that makes sense. And it doesn't, just set it up like how I have done here, and it's going to work anyway. All right. You saw that not everything was lined up perfectly, though. The orientation of the clones is not the same at the beginning as they are at the end, so we need to fix that. If I go to the cloner, there is a link box here called rail, so let's utilize that. Let me jump out of this camera and make a copy of the helix, and I will go to the coordinates, and on X I want to set this to 1. So the result is going to be two helix splines side by side, parallel from all the way at the beginning here to the end, and you can just see these two splines there. So now if I go back to the cloner, under rail I will drag this other helix spline, and as I do that you will see a slight shift in the way that the clones are oriented. And if I were to jump through this now again, this should now be lined up. And the reason that works is because it literally works like an actual rail would in real life. It's like two train tracks. Because they're parallel and next to each other, they stabilize the train that's moving along them. And it's exactly the same thing here. So now we have our loop, and this is exactly what we want. There is still another hitch going on here, which I don't know if you noticed, but if you pay attention to the orange clones, you will see they jump slightly at the end. If you look here, the third clone in, this is at frame 0, is the orange one, but at the end it's the second one, so it means that we don't have enough clones, or we have too much. So the reason that's happening is, if you look at the beginning, we have a small clone and then two large ones. But at the end, we have a small clone and then only one large one. This pattern is not repeating correctly. So we need to just increase the count until that's correct. So actually bumping this up to 51 almost seems like it might have fixed it, because we now have 1 and 2, which is the same as at the beginning. But I think at the halfway point this will be problematic, because 51 is an odd number. So let's go to 52, which actually, it fixes the center but not the middle here. So let's bump that up to 54. Okay, and I think that's what we need. And even by just looking at this, you can see that at the beginning we now have one small clone. The beginning stays the same basically, and two large ones. At the halfway point where the camera ends up, it is right in between that small clone, and then there's two large ones in front, and the spline ends the same way over here. So if you look where the camera is here, right, that position, compare that to at the beginning, it's exactly the same. So this should now loop correctly. Let me jump into the camera and hit play. I'm just gonna skip to like near the end here, and now you see we are back at the beginning, perfectly looped. Alright, so that's the looping finished. When I did this the first few times, these are things I eventually found out how to set up, the number of clones and so on. There were times where I was playing around with this control 2 down here, where I would tick it or untick it to see if that would fix my misalignment. And sometimes it did, and sometimes it didn't. It all just depended on what the scene was originally. I just remember having to do that a few times. But in the end, this is the setup I ended up going with. So this would still be just ticked by default. My count is something even, and you can just play with this until it looks right, adding or subtracting one or two clones. And the distribution is set to count. I mean, you also have things like align clone, which if I jump out, I'll show you the difference between when this is on and off. When it's off, the clones do not orient to the direction that the spline is going in. They are all just upright all the time, and that's just a different look that you may actually prefer. It's still going to loop, it's just going to look different. But align to clone, when that's switched on, you will now see that the clones orient in the same direction that the spline is going, and I prefer this look. All right, let's jump into the camera, and I'm going to turn on everything else. And here, I think the camera needs to be a wider angle. I will set this to half of 36, which is 18. So it elongates everything, especially stuff close to the edge of the screen. And it kind of makes it look like it's going much faster. So I like this look. And this was the style that I did in the final example animation. All right, so looking pretty good. Let's get some lights in this scene. I'm going to get the first light. And if I just jump out again, let's switch off this second level cloners. So the light comes in at 000, which is fine. I want to attach the same align to spline tag onto that light. So now it's basically moving with the camera. If I go to that tag though, I will rename it align to spline. In fact, I'll just call it light one. And that's what this is. I'm going to go to the details tab, and let's set the fall off to inverse square physically accurate. And this does not need to extend beyond the first clone. So just bring this in to about there. And if I were to jump through this again, turn on everything, do a quick render, we now get something like this. So this is pretty cool, but we obviously need a lot more illumination in the scene. But right now you can see these really cool highlights, which I have here. And of course, I'm going to provide this project what it was like at the beginning of the tutorial. So just look in this material. Let's see how this is set up. So this is from my sci-fi texture pack. I've made some adjustments to this though. So, you know, we just have the color channel, of course. Some diffusion on both reflection and specular. And I think diffusion also obviously affects the diffuse channel. So it darkens the whole texture. But really where most of the cool stuff is happening is in the reflectance channel. So let me break this down for you. It's three specular layers in reflection. The first specular layer, the mode is set to GGX, roughness 35, strength 5%, and it's just this fairly faint highlight. And then if I go to specular one, similar setup, GGX still, except that the roughness is turned down to 10%, which means this will be a sharper highlight. And then I've put the strength all the way up to 100. And then I just made a copy of that to double the effect. And then on top of that is just some normal reflection. You know, I've got a bit of Fresnel and so on, but nothing too complicated there. And that's it for the material. So, I mean, this will be provided as part of the project files for this tutorial. So take a look and break it down further if you need to. Okay, so that's how we get those really cool looking highlights. And also some reflections, actually. There should be reflections in this scene. So let me go back to the example here. If I copy this sky object, I'm going to paste it in the new scene. And let's do a render before and after that was added. So this is before, and this will be after. So it just takes a few seconds, and that's it. That's the difference. So with the reflections in the sky, you just end up seeing more of that detail as the reflections bounce around in the scene. Okay, and I mean, all that sky object is just this environment texture, nothing too special. And of course, this will be downloadable too. Okay, I'm going to make a copy of that light. Let's call it light 2. And this is going to be our visible fog light, which you see at the end of the, you know, this tunnel, really. And it's illuminating, it's also illuminating as well as being visible, which gives us a lot more depth in the scene. This is a bad quality example, but I think you see what's going on here. All right, so for this to work though, I need to go to the timeline, and this tag I will rename to light 2. This is in the basic tab here. This is where you change the name. So now I know it's this light, and I just need to offset this along the timeline so that it's always in front of the camera way over here. So the first keyframe is going to be set to 12.5%, and that's just a number I know works because I used it before, and it gives me where I can always see the light, but it's right at the edge of the vision of the camera. And then at the end, instead of being 50%, I will set that to 62.5, which if you do the math, it is 12.5% more than 50. So the offset along the entire of the animation is the same compared or relative to the camera. Okay, so now that light is always in front of the camera over there. Okay, so let me pause the animation, and I'm gonna go to the general tab on the light, and let's set visible light to be visible. And this is what will give us the fog or atmosphere effect. It needs to be wider though, so I will go to the details, or rather the visibility panel. It has its own separate falloff to the general light falloff. So this outer distance is what we need to change. I will set this to 1000, which I believe was what it was in the original example. And yeah, it's 1000. So let's jump back. And now if we do a render, you can see what's going on. And this is starting to really resemble the look that we had in the final project. And really that would be it for the lighting. Not much else going on there. It's very simple, high contrast kind of scene. There is one other element we need to add, and it might not be too obvious in the example video, and definitely not on this horrible quality version that I have. But there is some glass panels which are sort of floating around the main tunnel here. So let me show you what those look like. If I jump, let's say I turn this off. Let's go back to this project, and I'm gonna jump out here. There's two cloners down here with the cube with the glass material, right? So I'll make a copy of these. And I think those were also being cloned onto the helix with a rail setup. So let's keep that in mind. I will go back to our project, paste these here, and let's make sure to drop the helix spline in here. So that's the first one. And we need the rail as well, which just aligns it properly. And the same here. All right. So if I turn off the outer one, first of all, let's examine how this was built, because I think I might have just jumped too far ahead there. So I will turn off this cloner, this second first level cloner, and let's go to this and solo it by itself. So this is just a cube, right, with a height of 2 on X, 100 on Y, and 200 on Z. And oops, I just bumped that to 3 instead of 200, but here we go. And this is being cloned in a radial pattern, so that's the mode. and the count is set to 6, which corresponds to the 6 sides of our hexagon, and the radius is 212. So if your scene is like mine, when you and also I had to do this. So when I first dropped these into the cloner, they were, you know, facing the wrong way, so I had to put some rotation in the banking here, or the B, which is 90. And oops, I just knocked it down again, but here we go. And so when I unsolo that and turn it back on and drop it into the second cloner, which is the same setup as we had for the main cloner, so 54 clones with the helix and helix rail setup, it ends up looking like this. And if I re-enable these clones, it might be a little bit difficult to see what's going on here. So let me try and make it easier for you. I will turn off the lights, first of all, so that's already better. I'm going to create 3 layers in the layers over here. And let's drop the main thing, which is our main cloner, into the first layer. And then the first piece of glass, or the first set of glass clones, into the second one. And then this third one in the third. So now if I go to options, I can enable layer color. And that's what you're going to see in the viewport. So the yellow there is our glass panels, and they just line up on the inside like that. And if I was looking through the camera, you can see how that looks as the camera flies through. And this just added a lot more visual interest and detail into the scene, because now you have another level of just reflections bouncing around, and also refraction in the scene. So that's really cool. And then this third cloner is exactly the same thing, except just it has a higher radius. So it's kind of on the outside, and you can just see it through some of these gaps here. So let me jump out, and as you can see, that's where it is. It is a different shape of cube. So let me show you those settings. So it's 2 150 and 150 instead of 2 100 and 200 off the first one. But aside from that, the setup is the same, except the radius of this second clone, instead of being 212, which would look like that, it's a double. So it's a 424. And we have this. And again, that just adds another level of detail, because you have reflections and reflection bouncing around in the scene. All right, let me jump back in. And you know, we can stay in this view, or we can choose to see our textures again. It's entirely up to you. And I guess the glass material is worth mentioning. Transparency switched on, brightness 85%. The color is set to black, and refraction 1.5, which is I think just a simple glass material really. And in the reflectance, not much else going on. So that's it. And when I render, this is what I get. So really, really cool. I think there's something going on with the sky and glass panels. They're interacting, which I don't think they should be. If I remember correctly, I switched the interaction between those two off in the original example. So if I go to the sky, there is already a compositing tag on this. I'm going to exclude the two glass cloners. So if I do a render, the glass is only going to reflect and interact with the geometry, but not the sky. So there were some white blocks appearing, which are no longer there anymore. So that's great. Let's render this frame, and I think the final major difference between this and the example was that If I go to the light with the visibility, which I guess is the light number two, the fall off in the decay was actually 500, not 100. So a much larger radius on that light. And when I hit render, you see the effect of that. It's just makes everything brighter. And this is exactly what we want. This is before, this is after. All right, as far as setting up the scene, that's the difference. Let me show you another difference, which I should point out. I have loaded up the example on the YouTube channel, and you can see that the hexagons are actually curved. They have this inner curved edge, whereas in this example that I'm looking at, there is it's just, you know, there's sharp edges. So that was a slightly different scene. I will provide it as a download available to you. The reason why I didn't show it to you just now, or why I didn't build it exactly like that, is because those extra curves, I had to use I had to build the hexagon slightly differently with the splines instead. And it was just a much heavier scene in terms of being able to move around through it. But I will provide it as a download link, and you could use those hexagons with the curved edges in your scene rather than these flat ones. But that scene is more demanding on your computer than this one. So just something I thought I would point out in case anyone was wondering why there is that slight difference in the look. Aside from that though, it's exactly the same. The next step here is to do the render, or to set up the render. And I was using a super wide film aspect, so this Panavision preset down here, this was 24 FPS, and if I press Ctrl and D to bring up my project attributes, I should set this FPS to 24 as well. And if I go back to render settings, the anti-aliasing was set to best, 1x1, 4x4, I believe, with a threshold of 5%. Now, of course, I rendered this in 4K, so I probably ended up bumping down my max level to 2x2, so it wouldn't take too long. But you probably won't be doing 4K. You can really do this at any resolution you want. It's entirely up to you. But the frame range will be all frames, because we want to render the whole thing. And the other important thing here is we want some multi-passes. So if I enable the multi-pass in the save dialog here, we now have this multi-pass section. And I always save as a PNG most of the time, unless I'm doing something special. So even for the passes, that's also PNG and a 16-bit on both. And I would pick my save path. This could be anything for you. And the multi-pass layers we need, I'm just going to go ahead and add all of them. So add all image layers, and these are the options. Some of these we are not using, so there are no post effects, no atmosphere multiply. There is normal atmosphere. That's the pass that will carry the visible light, so that needs to be enabled. They are not caustics, GI, or ambient occlusion, or shadows rather, in this scene. So the only passes we have are these here. So ambient, that's the pass that will carry the luminant materials. So this orange light will be in the ambient pass. Diffuse, specular reflection, and refraction, those are just your standard image layers. And then atmosphere is the visible light. And you would save this wherever you want, and then you would output that wherever you want. So that would be the end of the Cinema 4D section. In the next video, I will go through the breakdown for the compositing